We do live in an evolutionary universe. It's been evolving for 13.8 billion years. And that's what we're here for. I mean, think of all that we come from. 13.8 billion years of evolution, of process, of growing. You know, there is a divine plan for everything. Now, it's not a plan that is, this is going to happen this time, when and when and when and when and when. But the plan is for us to grow and become, because in everything, there is a seed of potential, as Reverend Pam was saying, a little seed, a miracle in us that wants to grow and evolve and become. What happens, though, is in this process of evolution, we also have in us that seed of potential, but we have free will. Nobody's clapping on that one. Sometimes it would seem a lot easier if we could just let it happen, right? And somebody else was orchestrating the whole thing, but that's not the way it works. Yes, we are here for evolution and self-growth, but we have to discover it for ourselves. So, you know, we are growing and evolving and becoming, but it's at our own rate of pace and speed, and that's why we come together, so we can learn how to use this process, the law of unfoldment, the law of evolution, all of that, how we can use it in our lives to benefit ourselves and others. Now, if we think about this, this is not a new concept, this idea of the evolving a part of nature. So there's a physical growth, but there's also a soul growth that happens. So so this evolution is happening on the physical level where we can see it, but it's also, there's a soul growth that is guiding us. Well, Jesus would say to the kingdom of God, home, that's guiding us to our destination. But let me tell you something. God is the beginning. You know, we might think that the Big Bang is the beginning of everything, right? But what was before that? Darkness? Nothing? Pure potentiality. That is God, that is Spirit. So that's the beginning, and our destination is that place of oneness, where we so know our oneness with God, our peace of that divinity, that divine whole. That's our destination. But the thing is, everything in the middle is God too, because we have that seed of divinity that is goodness that wants to express through us. And that's our soul's journey of evolution. Buddha talked about this 500 BC. He talked about the ever-expanding soul, the soul that's always growing. And then Plato and Aristotle in 400 BC and 300 BC, respectively, talked about the same thing, the soul's growth. And they explained it as in the metaphor that we do of the seed and the soil. And then Jesus, he taught about the soul's growth too, but he taught to the multitudes using parables. He would tell stories. Some of them, they were all short, some of them shorter than others. I'm going to share the shortest one he did this morning, but he shared parables because parables meet people where they are. So everybody can learn from the story at a different level. And he would talk about the physical growth when he was asked about, oh, well, what is the kingdom of heaven? And he would explain in stories about growth. And he, just the physical growth, he had the parable of the sower, the parable of the mustard seed, the parable of the sprouting seed. And then the one I'm going to share that's mentioned twice in the Bible is the parable of the yeast or the parable of the leaven. And he said, when somebody said, well, what is the kingdom of heaven? He said, it's like a woman who has a big bushel. No, the kingdom of heaven is not like, I don't mean that. No, let me start that one over. The parable is when a woman has a big bushel of flour and a handful of yeast and keeps mixing the yeast into the flour until the entire bushel of flour rises. And that's what evolution is. When we fill ourselves so up with Spirit that we are one with the whole. Does that make sense? Does that make sense what we're doing and talking about? Good. Okay. So that's what it's all about. That's what we're here to do, evolve and grow and become. We can rest in the process. We don't have to work that hard. We can rest in the process, but that's what we're doing along the way. And then Ernest Holmes talked about the creative process, that everything starts in the invisible world, the spirit world, and becomes form. And one of the things we teach in our practitioner class over and over again, learning about the creative process, is the story of the seed and the soil. The seed is the divine idea. The seed is, we don't know what it's going to look like when it manifests completely, when it grows, but it's the divine idea. And for millions and millions and millions of years, well, I think that many millions anyway, people have known this process, that you know what seed you have, if it's a cucumber seed or if it's a rose seed or what kind of seed it is. You prepare the soil. You have to make it and get the clumps out and make it loose and make sure it has the nutrients it's needed. And then you plant this soil, the seed into the soil. And then what do? Yeah. Yeah. Wait. You have to do your part. Yeah, you got to make sure it has the sun and the water and all the conditions it needs to grow. But then you wait. But these farmers knew what kind of soil. They knew the seeds. They knew the time to wait. They had to wait, and they would harvest their plants. Now, the same is with what happens in our soul, our divine ideas that we have. We plant them in the fertile soil of our mind that has to be cultivated first, where those big clumps of fear and doubt and resentment and worry are free, and then that divine idea starts growing and coming into form. But we have work to do. We've got to be cleaning out our mind of limiting thoughts and ideas so we can be what life intends us to be, a beneficial evolutionary presence right here, right now. You know, I talked about that Big Bang wasn't the beginning of everything, because there was that whole bunch of potential that it came from, but it was the beginning of time. And time is a process of unfolding, a process of unfolding that is so important because everything builds on everything else. That's why I talked about that 13.8 billion years. Everything is building on everything else. If you think about it, this moment right now holds everything that has ever happened in the collective consciousness. The history of everything. And it holds all the potentiality of the future, of this moment. It holds everything in this single moment right now that we have. We get to decide how we're using every moment. Are we putting it in the pile of problem? Or are we putting it in the pile of possibility? We get to choose where we put every moment of our life, or in the time of rest and rejuvenation and, you know, whatever we need, but we decide how to use those precious moments of time. What are you deciding right now about your life in this moment? Are you putting in a pile of problem and feel weighted down? You know, it's interesting when we sang, you know, we're learning new things every day. We're growing every day. And when we sang that song, I Release and I Let Go, I always think, okay, I'm releasing all the stuff that I'm carrying, you know, so I can let spirit shine through. I'm releasing all that, right? Do you do that at all when you sing that song? I Release and I Let Go, you know, my doubt. But today I was just thinking, I release that divine potential in me. I release, it was a whole new idea, so I'm never going to sing the song the same way again. How cool is that? But we get to decide in every moment, because every moment has that potential to learn something new about life and about one another. You know, we have inherited this great potential, and sometimes we're not using it as wisely, efficiently, intelligently, lovingly as we can. A friend of mine who was born in the 12th century and has a four-letter name, talked about a man who inherited a great amount of wealth and land, and he squandered it away too quickly. And he said, some people who inherit things don't appreciate the work that was put into getting it. The same is with our soul, which has been given to us for free. And some of us don't realize how precious and valuable our soul is, not just to ourselves, but to this whole evolutionary process of life. Wow. He didn't say all that, but he said most of it. And I feel the same way. We have to take time every day. That's why we start our service with a very contemplative song to get us awakened, because this is a process of awakening. So I'm going to tell you right now some tools we get to use to awaken, to get our soul awake. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, are you listening?
Yes.
Okay, good. The first thing we need to really realize that every single thing has come from this unformed potentiality. Not just some things, everything has come from this unformed potentiality, which we can call God, love, spirit, whatever you want to call it, that creative energy, that everything. So we're all in the same boat. Everything comes from that place. And the second thing is we have to understand that that unformed potentiality is goodness. So if everything comes from that potentiality, there's goodness in everything, not some things, everything. Now, I always, when I see people acting horribly, I always say, we do better when we know better, and it's time for you to know better. Is there some way I can help? Because we do the best we know at the time. But there's goodness in everything. And the third thing that we have to know is we are on a journey, and death is not the end. It's the next evolutionary step to more wonderful. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians, it tells us that we shall ever unfold, transformed from one degree of glory to another degree of glory. It's not we grow from bad to better. We go from glory to glory. Doesn't that make you happy? Doesn't that feel good? That there's glory in everything always, and we're growing from one, maybe a little smaller degree of glory, but from one glory to another until we're connected with the whole. Wow, I love that. So everything comes from the formless potentiality. There is goodness in everything. That death is not the end, but a new beginning. And the last one, I really feel this is a good way to embrace the paradox of this crazy world at times. It's about waking up to being the most empowered individual we can be. Don't you like that? That's what all of this, the human potential movement is about. We need to be the most empowered individual we can be. So we can be the best version of ourselves out in this world of oneness. There's a wonderful new philosopher. He's not new. He's new to me. My daughter shared with me this weekend, Tim Freck. And I don't know, she called him Freak, but I didn't like that name, so I changed him to Freck. And he called this process, one of his lines is, we need to be an individual and a univisual. So we need to be empowered in ourselves, and we need to be part of the one. So that's balancing the paradox of this thing we call life. Being as good as we can be and know that we're part of the greater whole, and be in service, be in love, and care for ourselves, because sometimes we get confused. It's like, Barbara, when you said you feel guilty at times for serving, you're being part of that univisual, and it's perfect, and it's beautiful, and it's wonderful. So shroud yourself in beautiful appreciation, and that joy that you feel is just contagious for everyone. So that's beautiful. Now, if God is love, and would we all agree that's true because that's what we teach, that God is love, then if we talk about this evolutionary universe and we start in God from the beginning because that's the creative force from which we started, then we begin from love. And if the ending, our destination is God and our oneness with God, then what's our destination? What's our destination? And if it's all the same in between, that's really what life is all about. It's really about loving ourselves, our individual selves first. I mean, that's the same principle of being that empowered human being. And then loving one another, which is the same lesson and message that we've heard for so many years. You know, the thing, if we're doing this right, we can change our state of consciousness in several ways. You know, if we're feeling small and limited, we can first change it by thinking, using our mind through insight and contemplation, and letting go of our logic and reasonable mind and getting our intuitive mind activated. So it becomes insight. And when you get your intuitive mind activated, you can see life in a broader way, with a broader lens. You can get your insight, makes it larger eyesight. You can also expand your state of consciousness through art and music and nature by finding beauty everywhere. That's what I said, the goodness, finding beauty everywhere. And the last one is we can awaken our consciousness by dancing. Now, if you have two left feet, you don't have to be dancing with your feet. You can be dancing with your heart. It's being in that rhythm of life. Remember when St. Patrick talked about enthusiasm? He found a way to wake himself up and be dancing with spirit, and it was through his prayers. So we have to find something. Now, it can be physical movement, it can be physical dancing till you lose yourself and are so in the place of oneness. But what is it that brings you to that place of oneness? We have to be willing to find what it is that gives us that enthusiasm for life, that keeps us awake and alive and filled with potential, and that we're ready to release. The Bible says that God turns mourning, not M-O-R-N-I-N-G, but M-O-U-R-I-N-G, mourning, into joy and dancing. So spirit, it's the same thing. Spirit, prayer, however we find spirit, we're going to find that miracle of growth, that miracle, there's something more that I didn't even realize before. So I want to close with all of us just letting go a little bit and letting that childlike enthusiasm wake up in us. Just let that childlike enthusiasm, right? It's there. I know it's there right now. We've got to open to it. Remember, we've got to open up to dancing, open up to all those things. So be open to that. Be open to the childlike wonder of life. Our 13th century Sufi mystic Hafez says, every child has known God, not the God of names, not the God of, okay. Every child has known God, not the God of names, not the God of don'ts, not the God who does anything weird, but just the God who knows four words and keeps repeating them over and over and over again. Those words are, come dance with me. Come dance with me. Come dance. And my prayer today, on this day of celebration and festivity and, connection, celebration, my prayer for each and every one of us is that our heart will dance in any way that works for you, where you feel fully alive, fully in love, and fully at one-ment with the universe. That's my prayer for you.